Good evening, everyone. It's good to be here again after almost a year. Plain view, very good. Before I start, tonight's lecture will be on pride and general personality problems that we have, all of us. And we're going to learn in the next hour some of the things that we do, how severe they are, and the most important thing, how to correct them. How is it possible to correct it? But before we go into the lecture, I have an announcement. I just got the text. So the next lecture that I will have, which is in your area, is going to be in Great Neck on June 21st. It's next Sunday. Next Sunday, it's going to be in, at 7:30 at the house of the family. I think their name is Oef Shalom. And it's going to be 258 Shoreway Drive. In case you are interested, to let other people know, they asked me to announce 258 Shoreway Drive, Great Neck, next Sunday. This coming Sunday, June 21st at 7:30. When we basically review the situation of each one of us, what we call today Baalei Tshuva, people who are making repentance. A Baal Tshuva, it's not only somebody that was born wicked to a wicked area and grew up wicked and one day made Tshuva and he became Tzaddik. A Baal Tshuva is a person that most of his life was always Tzaddik, and every time he made a sin, a few times, he comes to correct it, he's automatically becoming Baal Tshuva. Some people are Baal Tshuva in one or two specific sins that they are doing, and once they correct it, so they made Tshuva on that particular thing. Some people need to make Tshuva almost in everything that Torah spoke about, because they messed up so much, there's a lot to correct. So he's a bigger Baal Tshuva than the other, because he had a lot more to correct. Some people make a partial Tshuva, that's unfortunately most people. They only make Tshuva at what's easy for them. They don't really address the real issues that they have, the real problems that they have, they ignore, they neglect. Why? When they see how difficult it is to correct, they give up. So they comfort themselves, they convince themselves that it's better that I do something than nothing, and I'm doing something, you know, and that should be good. I cannot do everything, I'm not perfect. So let me do some, I'll keep Shabbat, I'll put tefillin, I'll go to Minyan once in a while, not every day, when I'm not too tired. I try to eat kosher most of the time. What can I do if I go to a fancy wedding and the meat is not so, you know, so glut over there? What, I'm going to give it up? I'm bringing a very large gift, Rabbi, you know, how can I not eat? What? Oh, you know, the wedding is not 100% modest. No, okay, listen, Hashem understand me. I grew up in a place that, like Goyim, you know. The nature of the person is, remember, and it's all of us, is to lie to ourselves. A person is a very big liar. All the people, from the beginning of the world until now, had the nature to lie to themselves. Even people who don't lie to others, they constantly lie to themselves about their situation. They lie to themselves about their weight. They lie, how they lie to themselves. A person wants his wife to lose weight. Say, you know, darling, in a nice way, recently you allowed yourself too much. Why don't you go on a diet 1 week? Maybe you will lose a pound and a half. So after a week, he asks her, no, how are you doing? I don't know. What do you mean you don't know? You're not checking? No, I'm not going on a scale. Why? I don't want to go on a scale in between. Only when I finish my month, then I'm going to know. Why is it? Because a person doesn't want to check his real situation. He knows already it's not going to be great. So he closed his eyes. The Torah already announced people like this, Kisamnu kazav machsenu, like to hide behind the lies. Constantly. It's called, as a bird, it's called bat ya'ana. Bat ya'ana, when you attack it, it put the head inside the hole in the ground, like nobody is attacking. Once you attack it, right away, it has a very long, you know, it goes on two legs. In a safari, you always see, they come to the car. Ostrich, right? Ostrich. And they come, it's very dangerous. You know, you're very friendly with them, but if they get angry, they can make a hole in your head. Be careful. But you know, when you attack it, it puts the head inside the ground. And then you catch it quickly. Why? There's no danger. We are much worse than the bird. Why? Because we lie to ourselves about every step of our life, about our personality problems, about our bad habits, about lack of performance, about problems at work, even people who have business. Forget religion now. People that opened up a business 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, they're not profitable. They're not really making money. But the pride, the problems to admit that I fail is so bad for them, they will do everything they can to stay in this business as long as they can, until really they won't be able to. But how are they staying really in business? One loan after the other. They take a loan from this bank, so they survive another 2 years. When the money ran out, they're able to find from the uncle to take another loan. And then when this money is finished, they take from a friend. And then they begin to use one credit card, and another one, and another one. 5 years, they drive a nice car, customers are coming, everything looks beautiful. They even buy a house, they put down payment, everything looks great. Then one day the accountant comes and he says, "What's going on here? You owe $3 million. How did you do it in 5 years? So really, 5 years he worked from morning to night like a slave, losing money. Would be better off being a taxi driver, make a lot more money. But he doesn't want. The shame, the pride. Try to play a big shot. He has a business, employees, he gives orders. Like to live in a show, in illusion. That's what we are. Each one of us is a little bit different than the other, because each one of us has different weaknesses. Some of us are very proud. Some of us are a little bit proud. Some of us are very jealous. Some of us not so jealous. Some of us are generous. Some of us are very stingy. Some of us is a mixture of everything. We have a little of everything. Now remember, to correct some of the things that you do wrong, it's an achievement. Nobody can ignore it. The more you correct, the better it is. But it's not perfect. The question is, do you want to settle on 30%, tshuva, 50%, 70%? Of course, the more the better. Or you want to aim for 100%. Why? Even though we have to be realistic, the Torah says every Jew must say all the time, when I'm going to become like my fathers, Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. So Chazal asks, what is this nonsense? Who can be like Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov? How many people in the history was able to be like Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov? How many? Maybe 10 people in the history were more or less in that level that the Torah mentioned or the Gemara mentioned. How many people were? So what are chances? 1 to 1 billion? So what's the illusion here? To dwell, to dream. So the secret here, if you dream to be Abraham, maybe one day you'll be Rabbi Akiva. If you dream to be Rabbi Akiva, maybe you become the Rambam. You dream to be the Rambam, maybe you become Rabbi Ovadia Yosef. If you dream to be a football player, you'll be a murderer in the end, because you don't have any target in life. The idea is, if you aim for something big, there is a better chance. You don't aim anywhere, you give up to begin with. You have no plans for your future, no dreams. Yeah, we all have dreams. 99% of the Jews, unfortunately, and now all people, not only the Jews, in the world, what is their dream? To make money. If you connect a computer to the people's brain, you would find that 23 out of 24 hours a day, their mind is thinking money, money, money. In the middle of the davening, everybody, when you see them like this, you know they think parnasah. Hashem, this year I only made 1 million, but last year it was 3 million. Why are you so angry? 1 million is not enough. I have to move to a bigger neighborhood, better neighborhood. My house is only 20,000 square feet. Hashem, it's not enough for me. I don't have privacy there. You know, the cleaning lady, I have to see her twice a day. It's not comfortable. Everyone with his dreams, you know. The nature of the person, I'm telling you, it's guaranteed 100%. It's not my opinion, it's what the Torah says. When you get to 100, right away you become hungry for 2. You get to 2, you want 4. 4, 8. It's never going to stop. Even you be 90 years old, you have trillions of dollars, you're hungry for money. Don't ever think it's going to stop. Some of you may think, you know, when I'll make the first 10 million, I'll be much more relaxed than today. I'm not going to kill myself. You know, I have enough for me, for my children. I'll relax. I can go play golf. It will never happen. You'll be 90, you'll be hungrier than today. It will never stop. Just that the nature of the person, he thinks he's controlling it. But the Satan is a genius. Just when you're going to become very wealthy, he's going to tell you, what? You're comparing yourself to this Jew in the synagogue? Look at him. He owns 100 stores. You only have 3 stores. You're nothing. You're a puppet compared to him. You're nothing. Somebody told me, I heard your lecture about materialistic life. Even though I admit it's 100% correct, because I see on myself that this is what happens to me. I grew up in a poor house. I got married. My husband gave me everything I need. I have a beautiful mansion, fancy cars, tons of money, free credit cards, maids in the house, vacations a few times a year, houses to go for vacation. I'm the queen of my environment. I feel miserable. So I said, why you feel miserable? Because in a group of the ladies that we meet, I am the poorest one out of all of them. Just to give you an idea that this lady, she's a very good person. Don't get the wrong idea. Very good person, shomer mitzvot, spiritual, really classy, good quality person. Miserable all the time. Why? In the area where she lives, her house, let's say, worth $4 million, and that's a storage compared to all the mansions around her. So her friends look at her down, because her jewelry, even though it was $100,000 a piece, it's nothing they even look at, you know, or the brand names that she used compared to what they use. This is the competition that they have all their life. Bunch of fools making themselves miserable. Why is it? No Torah. When you have no Torah in your heart, it's not enough you have Torah in your shelf or you hear lectures here and there. If you're not connected with your heart to the Torah, you're miserable all your life. Just give you an example. There are some people who are willing to give fortune to buy pride, honor. Look at the competition to become the president of the United States. Who needs this headache? Look at the fight to become the prime minister of Israel. It's the biggest punishment in the world to be the prime minister of Israel. You don't have 1 minute of rest. Everyone curses you, demonstrations against you. They right away begin to investigate all your bank accounts and all your transactions to try to find something. Every day they make lies about you in the newspaper. You're embarrassed to look at your children in their face of what they hear in school and this and that. The salary of the prime minister is nothing compared to other countries. You know, some of you make 10 times more than him. And he fights for it. And some of them give up a very successful business. Some of them, what for? To become the prime minister of Israel. Why? Fame. I'll be a name in history. I'll be the most important person. But how much you're going to suffer? They don't have a minute to rest. It's not like in America, President Obama have time every Sunday 3 hours to play golf when America is collapsing. In Israel, if you play golf, they'll butcher you the next day. Forget it. You'll be blood spilled on the floor. That's what you're going to be. The Prime Minister of Israel can go play golf when the country is doing bad. They suck his blood for years about this. Only in America you see him cigar playing golf when everything here is collapsing. America is in the worst shape since it became a country in history. And they have time for vacation, private jet, good, great caviar and whiskey and playing. Supposedly they're controlling the world. Like I said, the more a person is lying to himself is to try to relax his conscience. Some people, they convince themselves that they're very righteous. For instance, they pray instead of normal hour in the morning, 20 minutes. They come very late to the davening. Chick, 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 1, 2, 3, and they live right in the middle. They got used to it. They don't see any problem. And they think, what a tzaddik I am. I come every morning to shul. But yet, they don't even do a third of what they're supposed to do. But they already got convinced from lying to themselves that it's no problem. Hashem likes it like this. Doesn't have to be fanatic. Same thing with honesty. 9 out of 10 times I say the truth, Rabbi. It's a great achievement, no? 9 of 10 people ask me 10 questions. 9 out of them I answer the right answer. Sometimes I lie, you know, I go around. Well, what's the big deal? The Torah says, Midvar sheker tirchak. The kosher rabbi has never lied once in the entire life. Rav Yaakov Kamenetsky, when he was a kid, 18 years old, something like that, in Russia, they invited him for Shabbos meal. And the woman made fish that tasted like poison. Just when he took the first bite, he almost vomited. So he took it out to the napkin. And then the woman came from the kitchen and said, Yaakov, you don't like this fish? It's not good for you? Now what is he going to say? Insult her in front of everyone? So he said, no, don't worry. I don't like fish in general. I don't like fish. I don't eat fish. Then after 5 minutes, he started to think, I just lied. I eat fish. I love fish. From that moment until the day he died, he never tasted fish ever again. His student, Berkovich, once went to ask him, Rabbi, everybody eat fish here every Shabbos. I saw you never touch the fish. Why? You allergic to fish or something? He said, oh, I love fish very much. So why don't you eat fish? When I was a kid, I said to a woman that I don't eat fish. I just was afraid that if I'm going to eat fish, it's going to be a lie. So once I told her I don't eat fish, I never tasted fish. Why? How can I go against one order in the Torah? The Torah says, stay away from lies. People got used to it. Every 5 minutes, a new lie in a business. Tell him I'm not here, the secretary. Mr. Cohen is not here today. He'll be back next week. Call him next week. He's right around the corner. Or he tells his kids, I'm not home today. I have headache. Why didn't you go to the shul? I don't feel good today. Then you're surprised why a year later he doesn't want to go to school. It's a chain reaction. I have a friend. We become more friendly with the years. A Persian man, a businessman. He has a nice office in Manhattan. I've never been in the office. But once in a while I call there to look for him. When I call him, the secretary pick up the phone. She doesn't know who's speaking because hundreds of people calling. It's a busy office. I call him. She say, I ask, is he there? She said, if he's there, she say, hold on. Right away, she transfer me to him. But she doesn't know who it is. I don't tell her names, nothing. So I told him the other day, you know, I know for sure I will sign 100% that you are a kosher, honest person. So how do you know, Rabbi? I say, you're the only person in the United States and perhaps in the world that when people call their office, the secretary don't investigate them 10 minutes on the phone before she transfers the call. Who are you? What is it in reference to? Does he know who you are? Did you speak to him before? 500 questions. Even you tell her it's something personal. Yeah, but I know, but what is it? Would he know what is it about? Where are you from? What's your last name? Why? People owe money, they have enemies, they try to cheat them, to lie to them, they owe money, so the people call for their money, they don't want to answer. So the secretary is trained. You're going to be my bodyguard, save me from all my lies. But when a person is clean, why should he be afraid to pick up the phone? When a person is afraid to come to the phone, right away, you know, don't do business with this guy. Something is fishy. Somebody that is clean, he comes to the phone. The biggest rabbis, in the days they had telephones in Israel, they used to come and pick up the phone. They didn't need people to screen the call for them. Right away, he comes, the old man comes, he picks up the phone, he answers people questions. All the time. Doesn't have to be afraid of anyone. Today it's all bureaucracy. Until you try to speak to an important man, people, when today, if you don't have a secretary, people don't hold of you as an important person. Somebody call your cell phone, let's say you put your cell phone on a card, and you give it to people and they call you, they don't believe that you're the one who picks up the phone or in the email. Oh, I can't believe you answer my email. Because they're already used to a chain of assistants and helpers. The big shot is never doing such things. It all comes from one source, pride. Pride or humbled? Where are we? Let's see. Let's see what the Torah has to say about pride. We start in a book called Orchot Tzadikim in the first chapter. It's a book that speaks about bad traits, bad personality. What is the first trait that is speaking about? Pride. Why? Because it's the worst problem. From all the problems, it's the most dangerous risk to the person's life is to be proud. Let's see what he says, and he brings sources from the Torah and the Gemara about pride. Ba'alei ha-gava, someone who is proud, he is despicable in the eyes of God. Did you ever find a worse word to describe a person? Despicable, metu'av. In Hebrew, the Torah used sometimes the word to'ava. To'ava. When the woman is naked on the street, Hashem called it to'ava. When people made sex crimes, the Torah says to'ava. When people do avodah zarah, the worst things in the whole Torah, the Torah used the word to'ava, despicable, dirty, ugly, horrible, and I don't know if we have to find the right word for it, but it's definitely the worst title that you can find. And what does it say? Ba'alei ha-gava meto'avim be'inei Hashem. They are despicable in the eyes of Hashem. As the book of Mishlei Tetzayin, it says, To'avat Hashem kol gval lev. Someone that feels higher than others is despicable in the eyes of Hashem. And because of that, as results of his pride, what happened to him? His evil inclination overcome him easily. Surrender him, 1, 2, 3. Cannot fight against your desires. Why? This is the result of being proud. So let's see the source. Tomorrow when you cannot hold yourself from not eating something non-kosher, or when you steal, or when you cheat somebody, or when you insult a person, and many other things that we do, what's the source of it? Even though you don't see connection, it's the fact that you are a proud person, not humbled. Not only that, there is no help from Hashem to this person. No siyata dishmaya. When he begs Hashem, help me, I'm in problem, Hashem has no desire to help this person. Not only that, even if he's not proud on any human being, by speaking, he doesn't say, I'm handsome and you are ugly, I'm rich and you are poor. No, not such low life. We're not talking about somebody like this. Only in his heart. He did not do anything in action, and he did not say a word to hint that he's proud. Only in his heart he thinks, what am I doing with these people around me? What am I doing here? It's not my class, these people. Right away, Hashem puts him in a category of people that he cannot stand. Then, we continue the Gemara in Sotah Dalet. I'm bringing you all the sources. Later you can go to see the video in divineinformation.com. You can write yourself the sources. You can go and check in a book if I'm exaggerating or not. I read it. I copy from all the most important book in Judaism. And I bring you all the sources. And I tell you why I'm so confident that all of us are proud. Because it's very, very rare to find a person that is completely humbled. Now, even if you are 5% proud, which is a big achievement compared to the generation, it's still something that must be corrected. Even that is too much. So a person must be humbled, and that's something that is not easy to reach. And we're going to talk how we can get to it. Every person that is proud automatically becomes arrogant. He has no patience to other people. If people ask him more than once a question, he begins to get angry at them. He laughs at foolish people. There are a lot of foolish people out there. It's not their fault that they're born like this. Not everybody born Albert Einstein, you know. So if your brain is not exactly a computer, right away he looks at you down. He cannot stand you because you're annoying. You ask the same question sometimes 3, 4 times. And somebody like this automatically have hundreds, perhaps thousands of enemies. All his employees hate him. All his partners hate him. His wife hate him. His children hate him. His parents hate him eventually. His brothers hate him. His neighbors hate him. Every place he go, business, customers, everybody hates him. Why? Because the mind of a person is equal. Everybody think the same. Even proud people cannot stand other proud people. Check. When you see a person that brag about himself in a television show, right away, the next day on a newspaper, everybody say, what a loser, what a show-off. When yet some of the people who write are much worse than him when it comes to pride. But even they are allergic to proud people. That's how bad is this trait. Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul, which was the biggest rabbi in the world, passed away 10 years ago. He was the most perfect human being that lived in this generation. The best. The biggest Talmid Chacham, the biggest Mekubal, Persian, biggest Mekubal in the world. And what's the greatest about him? If you wouldn't know who he is, you'd stand in a wedding, he would stand next to you around the chuppah, you would never ever guess that this is the most important person in the whole world. Why? So humble, regular jacket. The rabbis had to force him, eventually after many years, to wear a long coat. He did not want to show any sign that he's somebody important. They wanted to give him a driver, he did not agree. Only when he became paralyzed in the last years of his life, they got him a driver. But all the years when he was healthy, he refused to have a driver. They offered him all kinds of jobs, the chief rabbi of this, the chief, never agreed. People used to come ask him questions. He said, why are you asking me? Ask this rabbi, ask him. He never pushed his nose to other people's arguments or questions. Even though he knew the answer, he could save them a lot of time. Nobody asked me, it's not my business. So he gave one time an example of proud people. And he said like this. Sometimes in shul, you see the people who help to build the shul, they made themselves a special bench next to the rabbi. It's called in the Mizrach, in the east, next to the Aron Kodesh. In Brooklyn, I saw in some of the synagogue, they have beautiful stages. But God forbid, maybe somebody will miss that he sits over there. It's a very high stage. Everybody has to see where he sits. There's a room for the gabbaim and the rich people that sponsor the shul. They have a VIP here. The rabbi sits on this side. It's all planted like this, that every step on Shabbat, when you walk into the shul, everybody comes. The next thing, they're going to come and clap for him. But that's how it is. So he says, we see sometimes people like this, when somebody in normal shoes, they don't have a stage. So it's the first row, usually, the important people. So sometimes a guest came to the shul, accidentally there was no chair to sit. He sat in their chair. They get very angry. They ask him, excuse me, sir, it's a private chair. They move him out, go sit in the end. So he says, look at them. For years they're behaving like this. Everybody laughs at them. Everybody laughs at them. Now proud people, the worst thing you can do to them is make fun of them. Then it's a world war. You begin an atomic war here. Laugh at a proud person, he's going to kill you if he can. It's worse than shooting him. That's how bad it is to hurt, to make fun at him and make a joke, tell people that he's stupid or something like this. Forget it. Never forget you. His pride, his ego. So sitting in his chair right away is fuming. And not only that, he knows that when he's going to raise this person from the chair, everybody's going to laugh at him. But he cannot help it. He's so eager to sit in a Mizrach, in an important place, that he doesn't care about anything else. Not only that, there was one rabbi that once in his lecture he spoke about himself. And he said, you know, I all my life been very poor, he said. I was living from a small salary from the yeshiva, and that's what I had in Israel. When my student used to get married, they used to send me an invitation, and I knew I'm going to get a special bracha in a wedding, one out of the seven. And you know how it is in a wedding. Ya'amod, we invite the great genius, Gaon, the Chacham, the Rosh Yeshiva, the great rabbi, such and such, to make a bracha. Everybody gets up from him, he walks, he feels that, whoa, me and Hashem is the same level already. So he said, when he didn't get a ride, he was very poor, he used to take a special taxi, private taxi, to take him to the wedding, not to miss these 5 minutes of pleasure. He was doing so great for him. Until over the years, he worked on these terrible things and he got rid of it. So now he was making fun at his old character, how he used to be. He say it's a sickness, it's a mental disease. A poor person is spending now $100 with a cab to go all the way to Jerusalem to the wedding for 10 minutes that they're going to call his name on a microphone for everybody to give him respect. $100, 3 days he has to work for it, for these 5 minutes of honor and special pleasure that he gets. Why? Mental disease. Logically, it doesn't make sense. Anyway, tomorrow nobody would remember him. These 5 minutes of pleasure that he gets, forget it. Then the Torah continue. He become arrogant, and he's count like someone who worshipping idols. Why? Why does a person that is proud is count like somebody who bowed down to an idol? What's the connection? The answer is, why a person that is angry at others, usually it comes from pride. Somebody hurt his feelings and he gets angry and he begins to attack. When a person is angry at others, that automatically shows that there's no God in his life. And Hashem. Why? It's me against him. He hurt me, I gotta take revenge. But when a person lives with Hashem in his heart, in his mind, he never gets offended from anyone. He only gets embarrassed that Hashem sent him this punishment. Why this thief came to me and not to my friend? Because I'm guilty right now, I deserve to lose. Why the robber came only to my house and nobody else in the neighborhood? Because I'm the one who deserved it. And many, many other examples in our life. But we don't want to take responsibility. Then Chazal continue. Kol adam sheyesh bo gasut haruach. Everyone who's arrogant. Maybe you put the air condition if you ask. Except me. Except me. All right, good. So I'm not the only crazy one here. Now we are two. All right. So, it's okay. I'm joking. Every person that is arrogant eventually collapse. Eventually collapse. He can do very well in business for many years. Why? Because then the rule when God's, the way God treats us, is בדרך שאדם רוצה ללך מוליכים אותו. The path that a person is choosing to walk through, Hashem is guiding him to go through that path. Even though he's very not satisfied from your choice, Hashem gives you the energy to go and steal. You chose to steal, he helps you to steal. You chose to kill, if the person is guilty and he deserves death, then Hashem helps you to kill. Without you, Hashem would kill him in a different way. Since you wanted to kill him, Hashem helps you to kill him. You wanted to insult a person, if that person is guilty and he deserves an embarrassment, Hashem helps you to go and embarrass him. Who gives you the energy to talk? How is it possible? The answer is, life is a test. Every step here is a test. The entire reason that Hashem made this world is for a test. What is the test? The Yetzer Hara, the evil inclination, the free choice to do good or bad. You chose to do bad, I must help you to do the bad. Later I'll punish you for that. But that's what you chose, that's why you are guilty. The only people who go to jail is people, not animals. Animals don't go to jail even if they just brutally murder the zebra. Do you ever saw a trial to the lion that he murders so many zebras every week? With no mercy? No, it's nature. They live by instincts. He's hungry, he's attacking. He doesn't have a free choice. Did you ever see a photographer come to the lion? Excuse me, the king of all the animals, your honor. Wait 5 more minutes, I didn't finish my pictures. Before you attack, give us 2 more minutes, and then you eat him. We want to take a few more pictures. The lion eats. Cannot stop him. There's no way to stop them. Animals are animals. But when a person does something wrong, jail, penalties, court, police. Why? Because he's guilty. He chose to do bad. Then he's collapsing in the end, like we cut the tree of Avodah Zarah from the roots. As the prophet Yeshaya 10, verse 33, Verameh akoma gduim, those who are considering themselves above the rest, their end that they will be cut from the roots. This is words of wisdom of the Torah, not all kinds of orders, wrote books, and they give us recommendation. This is all Torah from Sinai. Hashem gave it to us. This is the opinion of our Creator. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu crying about him, for that person. Shechina meyalelet alav. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, in this world, I cannot be around that person. It's either him or me. If he is there, I am not going there. If he's not there, I can come. Why? Because he's also God. He considers himself God. He's a master. He gives orders. Nobody can say anything to him. Somebody like him cannot be with me at the same place. And that's what the Gemara in Baba Batra said. Ha'iman de'ayir afilu ananshe betelo mitkabel. A person that is proud, even the people of his house cannot stand him. And that's what I just said before. As we continue, the proud person will never listen to the miserable poor people. When they stand online to collect from him, he has no feelings for them. If he is forced to go to their home, he looking at them like stink people. Sruchim, miserable, what am I doing here? When can I leave already? When he speaks, he has no fear to speak against righteous people and put them down and say bad things against them. When he eats, you see right away that he's proud, the way he eats. When he gets dressed, you see right away from the clothing if he's a proud person or not. Also, he will have strong desire to dress like the goyim, not like Jews, because he doesn't want to be an ordinary one. The Jews used to wear all the same. He wants to be special. Why would I? It's like somebody in school, they have uniform, but he doesn't want to come with uniform. He wants to dress beautiful. The uniform is, he's going to do everything he can to cancel this rule. And the Torah warned us in Sefer Vayikra 20, don't follow the laws of the goyim. Don't follow their customs. And then in another place it says, be careful, that's going to be a major trap to you if you're going to follow the way they dress and the way they behave. And then, as we always knew, that the Jew is different than all the other nations in the way he dresses and the way he behaves. Sheneemar v'avdil etchem min ha'amim. I separated you from all the other nations. The pride brought a person to run after money. Why? That's the tool that helped him to fulfill his mission. He wants to be the boss of everyone. Without money, he cannot do anything. That's why he's very anxious and eager to get as much as wealth as he can. The more money he's going to have, automatically he's going to gain more power. He cannot live with this power. Just the last 3 weeks, everybody in Israel speaking about one person. One movie star is on television. He was the most famous comedian and in talk shows for maybe 30 years. Comedies, very famous. You used to see him every hour on television, prime time, everywhere, all the stations. You know, he got older. He's not so attractive anymore to the crowd. And the managers in the television station closed their door for him. They don't want him. Say, you're obsolete already, you know. Guess what he did? He told his wife, I can't live with this shame. It kills me that I don't get the attention I used to get. So I'm preparing you that something is going to happen. She didn't know what he's talking about. 2 weeks later, after he told her that, the police arrested him, that he hired murderers, mafia people. He hired them, gave them a lot of money to go break the bones of all the people who disagreed to do business with him and to put his show on television. So he took a head of one television station, they attacked him brutally, broke his bones, left him bleeding on the floor. A week later, a woman, they beat her up, they almost killed her, they smashed her whole face, they broke her nose. She was in a hospital for days, surgeries. Why? The police got a list of all the people that he wanted to take care of them. Among them was one of his ex-wives. He had few ex-wives, you know. He's in style, you know. It's modern. It's in fashion today, Rabbi. What? One wife only? You primitive. I already had 16. So, what happened to him? They put him in jail. Now he gets a lot of attention. Everybody's speaking about him. Everyone is shocked. How can it be? So what is the first thing he does in jail? An hour he's in jail. He tried to kill himself. He took a needle with insulin. He has diabetic. He injected a lot of insulin to his body, hoping it's going to kill him, to raise the blood sugar in the body, and hopefully he'll die. But unfortunately, he didn't die. For him, unfortunately for him. He wanted to die. Then the next day, he got a heart attack. Why? Because for the proud people, the shame is the number one killer. Did you ever see in a boxing match? Boxing match, the people who box, they have a lot of ego. So all these black boxers, you know, they took them from the neighborhood. They don't even speak two words in English. They have all gold teeth and these tattoos all over. They used to be the biggest criminals in the neighborhood, but they like murderers, they thirsty for blood. So they train them to be boxers, and they make tens of millions of dollars for fight, and they become very rich. And eventually each one of them lost all his money. Not exactly the most genius people on earth. So did you ever see what happened to them when they get knocked out to the floor? What happened to the boxer a second after he crashed to the floor? The referee is counting. 1, 2, 3. Then it goes 10. And they ring the bell. And everybody screams. Yeah, there's a new champion of the world. But what happened to the loser? He's about to die in an hour. In an hour later, you hear that he died in hospital. But as he's dying, he gets up and he goes like this to the crowd. I'm still standing. He goes like this to the crowd. And everybody clap. Oh! Why? He doesn't mind to get all the physical pain in the world and even to die to prevent 1 minute of embarrassment. The physical pain is nothing compared to the spiritual pain. The spiritual pain that for years everybody will say he was on the floor and he couldn't get up. To prevent that, he's going to make himself a permanent damage to his spine, to his head, everything. Just to avoid the embarrassment. Then, the Torah gives us few examples of people that the pride destroyed them. One of the most famous ones is Korach. Korach and 250 chief rabbis. Why, Moshe, you are the leader and we are nothing? That's how it started. Politics. We have it plenty today, everywhere. It started there. Moshe is saying the words of Hashem and they get angry. You and your brother controlling us? What, you better than us? Even though they heard that Hashem nominate Moshe in Har Sinai to be the prophet, they disagree. Wow, we're not less than you. It's not fair. They came to destroy Moshe. What happened to them? They all got buried alive. As the pride leads to jealousy. Jealousy. You cannot be proud without being a jealous person. Why? Because if somebody else attracts attention, it takes away from your pleasure. Now you only have half. Somebody else takes attention. For instance, when there are two singers are singing in the same event, there's always a fight who's going to be the first and who's going to be the second. Why? The proud doesn't agree to be the first one because it makes him look less. I'm warming the crowd for him? No, he's going to warm them for me. It's all about this. Or sometimes two speakers don't want to be in the same stage. Why? They know the other one is better. They don't want to look gray compared to him. So they make excuses. It's all about pride. It all starts and finishes with this, pride. Jealousy. Then a person that doesn't get respect is fighting for the respect. So he begins to fight with people that they disrespect him. And he wants to take something that Hashem is not interested to give him. And he begins to have arguments and hate. And forgets HaKadosh Baruch Hu. The next thing, he doesn't care about the mitzvot. All he cares about is that people will give him the right attention. And he forgets that in the end, the worm's going to eat his body completely. All this body, the muscles, the clothing, everything that he does. There are all kinds of proud people. Some are proud about their intelligence. They are intelligent. They have masters from good universities, so they make sure that everybody knows it. Some are doctors. If you call them without saying doctor, they get very angry. Some of them, they're not even embarrassed to say, excuse me, Dr. Cohen, not Mr. Cohen. They get very angry. If somebody would write their name without giving them their title, like judge or doctor, they can even sue them for disrespect. It's hard to believe. Some proud people, they always worry how they look for the ladies to like them, because they brag about their look. And these kinds of proud people usually are big jokers. They like to tell jokes, because this is the way they come to the girls. Oh, and they're saying a joke, they begin to laugh. What a cute dog. And one thing leads to another. This is things that was written 2,000 years ago. It didn't start today. You know how they say in Manhattan, the way to the woman's heart is being nice to her dog. You know, because they all have dogs. They take the dogs on Manhattan. You see these guys that go with 20 dogs in the street. You know, sometimes you see people, among them Jews, they love their dogs so much. They take care of them. They take them to the barber, to the doctor. They buy them gifts. They give them special bed, massage even. You know? And God forbid, if somebody kicked their dog, for instance, they gotta go crazy. One time I went on Shabbat, to Upper West Side. That was 14 years ago. I saw something I'll never forget. A woman came down from the elevator with a big dog. There was inside a building in Upper West Side, there's a shul on the second floor of all the college kids. They have a dorm over there. They daven Erev Kabbalat Shabbat. Somebody took me to daven there. I said, where is the shul here? He said, the closest one is right here, across the street on the second floor. Modern Orthodox, all students, they davening their Kabbalat Shabbat. But the problem is, when you walk into the building, you have a lobby, you have a little candy store. Just when we come after the davening on the way home, this woman came down from the elevator and the leash of the dog stuck inside the elevator. The elevator started to go up with people and the dog choked to death. But the way he was choked, you hear the dog screaming, ah, you know, like all over the building, everybody turns around. The next thing I saw this woman falling on his body, crying, screaming, ripping her hair, relax, screaming. Believe me, much worse than people cry for their own kids. She couldn't relax. It's been going on and on, screaming. Sometimes I see people, they give all their inheritance to their dogs. They leave an apotropos, somebody that will be in charge of the money, to make sure their dog have great life. It's not a joke. It's happening all the time. One idiot Jew made a bar mitzvah to his dog. And it's all over YouTube. That all the 6.4 billion goyim would laugh at the stupidity of the Jewish people today. The nation was the greatest nation in history, have such idiots among them. I think it's very cool to make a bar mitzvah to my dog, why not? Got him tefillin. You think I'm joking, huh? You're laughing and I want to cry. Hard to believe. Mamash, hard to believe how low people can be. Anyway, people that have dogs, they do not know that actually they are the servants of the filthiest animal on earth. They don't know that. They have to clean the bathroom of the dog on the streets, to feed him, to care for him, to bring him in, to take him out, to bring him in. He barks, he doesn't let them sleep. They go with him to places, somebody went against the dog, they get very offended. They don't really see. But there are three cursed animals in the Torah. The snake, the crows, and the dogs. And the dog has the filthiest nefesh. The spirituality of the animals, they have also a limited spirituality. It's called nefesh. Blood. The blood is the nefesh. The Torah said not to eat the blood of the animals. That's why we put salt to get rid of the blood. So the Torah said that from all the animals, he has the worst spirituality, the dog. He's a cursed animal because they made sins in Noah's ark. So Hashem cursed them. The creator of all dogs, the creator of 2 million different kinds of animals that we know today, decided that the crows, the dogs, and the snakes are despicable, cursed animals. And what is the Jew doing? Serving the dog. The most important spiritual thing in life, serving the dog. Now I know many people that have dogs getting very offended right now. What can I do? The truth hurts. The truth hurts. What can I do? What do you want me to make the dog? The King Solomon? What do I make him now? Next time, when you choose an animal, take a horse. At least, yeah, at least you can save gas on the way to work.
Take him for a walk.
Yeah. Anyway, you don't have to take him to a walk, the horse. Very easy. You give him straw to eat, finished. Then, women. The pride of the women, other than women that are proud on their intelligence, the number one kind of pride that you find among women is their body. Their hair, their beauty. That's why they always make sure to put lipstick and this, whatever you call it, in their eyes. And then she goes on a date 15 times. She goes into the bathroom even though she didn't drink nothing today. She goes to the bathroom 15 times. Why? Because every 5 minutes she needs to check in a mirror that she's still very beautiful like she was 5 minutes ago. That's what it is. And then when she sits in a date with a guy, I always tell my students, you want to know if she likes you or not? Count how many times she goes like this with her hair. He goes like, you don't have to put a show anymore. That's it. It's a done deal. You can propose already. Why? If she doesn't like you, you think she's going to waste time like this 20 times? This is it. The men also have problems. Don't be so happy. But anyway, the women, the most important thing is what the people's going to say about the look, which is beauty and body and their clothing. And that's what they sacrifice their life for. Why do you think all the gyms are packed? Gym. You tell the woman, you know what, if you want to work on your body, to lose weight and to be in a good shape, save me the money for the gardening. Cut the grass. Walk with the machine back and forth every week. You lose some calories. No, it's embarrassment. The neighbor's going to see me. They're going to think we're crazy. I'm doing the job of the gardener. A minute later, she goes to the gym. Private trainer. What are you doing until 11 in the morning? I have a private trainer. Okay, so when you're done at 11, then we have a coffee shop there in the gym. We sit with friends until 1. Her husband killed himself at work, pays for her sitting in the gym every morning until 1. Okay, after 1, what do you do? I got to do my nails. Okay, what time, how long it takes? Now it's already 2:30. Okay, 2:30, what do you do? I call to my mate to make sure she picked up the kids from school. Okay, so now what? It's 3 o'clock already. Now I need to go to a restaurant to eat with my friend's lunch. Okay, so now it's 5 o'clock. What do you do by then? My husband is coming home. I have to come home to make sure he's coming home. This is their life. Did you read Tehillim today? I didn't have time. I was very busy today. Did you do any mitzvot? Did you help the poor? Did you teach your kids something? So many things to do. Did you help your husband in anything? That's the situation that we're in today. Most important thing, how much attention we're going to get. So when the religious women decide to go to the wedding, how do they decide what they're going to dress? Depend what kind of people going to be in a wedding. If it's important, beautiful people, she wear a very tight skirt or whatever. She cannot wear a mini skirt. She's religious. She's embarrassed. They're going to make fun of her. What kind of religious girl you are? But the skirt that she wear is basically the same level. So tight that she want to get up to do Netilat Yadayim, it takes her 15 minutes to walk to the sink like this. Why? It's all pride. It's a mental disease that we have and we don't pay attention to. What is she going to gain for suffering so much? Somebody will come and tell her, you look so beautiful tonight. Her aunt, her roommate, ex-roommate, whatever. Somebody will give her a compliment. How much are we willing to suffer? They pay thousands of the gowns on the clothing, trying 15 times. What for? What all this show? I saw some righteous women, not in their life they put makeup. Their hair get gray, they're still young. They can dye their hair, I don't care. I have to be pretty. For anyway, I cover my hair in the house. Nobody sees me in the street. What's the big deal? Who do I have to be pretty for? For my husband. My husband accept me like this, finish. I don't have to do a show for the people around. So then the Torah continue. The gava, the pride, is the source of all desires. The source of all desires. Let's see. Desires for ladies, desires for food, desires for all kinds of beautiful things, nice houses, nice cars, jewelry, clothing. It's all come from the root, which is the pride. A very humble person, even a goy, he doesn't care about his car or about his house or about what he wears. He buys a suit for $50. He doesn't care. He doesn't understand what's wrong about it. Even goyim, it's in the, depend on their nature, if you're proud or not. Then, when the person cannot reach all his desires, he becomes a thief. Why? He doesn't have enough money to buy all this. How many people move to special certain towns? You know what I'm talking about. They couldn't afford the houses that they went, but they forced themselves to move to that area that they will show the community that they're also in their style, in their level. We have to leave the rabbi. It's all of our community. But you don't make enough money to even pay for half of this house. Why are you killing yourself so much? Why are you borrowing? You're working extra work. You're trying this. You're always upset. You're always under stress. For what? To show to who? How much you suffer for this pride. Then they don't have patience to anyone. No patience. Then they put people down, and you know, when you insult a person, chas v'shalom is one of the worst sins. It's almost like a murder to insult a person in public. When a person is insulted, what happened to his face? It become red. Why? All the red blood balls inside the face explode and the blood spills inside. If you didn't have skin, it all comes out. That's why a person become red when you embarrass him. Also, his body temperature rises tremendously when he gets embarrassed. He begins to sweat. That's why the Torah says, "Ke'ilu shofech damim." It's count like he spilled his blood. And that's an embarrassment to embarrass another person. Like, for instance, I went to Shabbaton, and one woman finally decided to cover her hair. And then she started to be embarrassed from the looks of some of her friends. So she took it off. And then one woman, as foolish as she can be, she came to her, "Oh, finally I can see your beauty after you took that shmada from your head." Now this woman, first she did it in front of others, so that's called malbin pnei chavero barabim. It's a very, very big punishment for that. Poor woman, she's going to get severely punished. Probably she's not even aware how severe is her sin. And the worst thing is, now this woman, and the next time she's going to want to cover her hair, because this is what Hashem says for the Jewish ladies to do, she won't have the guts to do it. Because in her mind, psychologically already, she thinks, that's what the people are thinking about me. So when she comes in front of Hashem, before he punishes her for problems with modesty, who is the partner to the crime? That woman. Now this woman will say, Dear Hashem, where is the justice? What did I do? I only say one sentence. You punishing me like hell? She wasn't modest for 50 years. Now you're giving me the same punishment? The answer is yes, because it's your fault. Without you, she would be modest. And Lashon Hara and many other things that we do, and we don't know how far it's traveled. But of course, people don't want to hear the truth. Why people don't want to hear the truth? The nature of the people, when they hear lectures about Musar, ethics, they run away, they're not coming. When there's good jokes, it's packed. But when it's ethic, people are suffering inside, in their conscience. They're suffering, they're literally suffering. They see it and they think, when is it going to end already? I can't take this anymore. This is because of our stupidity. The Torah says to be the opposite of this. The Torah says when someone tells you the truth in your face, you must kiss their hands. If you're brave enough, you kiss their feet even. Thank you very much for telling me the truth about myself. Why? I can correct 20% of what you said. That's a big achievement. Without you, I would stay the same forever, thinking I'm okay. My conscience didn't bother me when I walk naked in the street. Until you came and told me that I dressed like a prostitute. Now I realize, yes, because in the eyes of Hashem, you don't know who Hashem called a prostitute. A girl that lifts her skirt to the knee used to be a prostitute in the time of Chazal. Chazal described a prostitute. Who is a prostitute? Someone who has clients in hotel rooms? Hashem Yirachem? No. Today, that's a prostitute. In the time of the great holy rabbis of the Gemara, that we read their names in the Gemara, when they wanted to describe a prostitute, it was a woman that dared to lift her skirt to the knee to attract attention. So where are we going to be today? Comparing what the Gemara demands. Very far from the truth. I show you ladies 70 years ago, non-religious communist ladies in Hungary. 70 years ago, how they used to dress. Very wide skirt, couldn't see the image of the body even an inch. Very wide, clothes up to here, clothes. Completely modest. Hate Hashem. Communist. Communism is anti-religion. The communist Jewish movement in Hungary, in Russia, in Poland, that destroyed millions of Jewish souls. How they used to dress? Completely modest. Why? I'm a woman, I have dignity. I have respect to myself. I'm not an animal on the street that show a body. A daughter of a queen, of a king. Queen, a princess. You check in the history. All the queens. Did you ever see Queen Elizabeth with miniskirt? Or with short sleeves? Ever. Show me one picture of her with this. Show me one. Even the relatives don't have, because she never dressed like this. She's not religious. Why? She understands, I'm a queen. I'm important. I cannot wear shorts, run in Central Park. What is this? Oh, and she was young, 40 years ago. She was still a queen. She never did. The wives of the presidents, you never see them naked on a camera. One guy said, you know, what is the problem? Well, a woman wants to go and dress like this. Who cares? So I asked him a question. I say, you agree that you're going to have a party with 300 guests in your living room and your wife going to come out of the room with bikini, bathing suit, in front of everyone, like this, to the living room? I said, oh, you crazy? Who would agree such a thing? So if she would do such a thing, what would you do to her? He said, it would be the end of the marriage. I wouldn't be able to forgive for something like this, to embarrass me like this in front of everyone. So I say, let me ask you a question. Do you go with your wife to the beach? You say, yes, to the pool, to the beach. She dressed like this in front of millions of people? You say, yes. You're not embarrassed over there, right? You say, no. Why? Because everyone is like this. But in the living room, it's not acceptable. Look at this fool. HaKadosh Baruch Hu said, the woman has to be modest. Did he say where? always in her bedroom, even with her husband. Learn the love of intimate relationship between husband and wife. You're not going to believe. Even near the walls, they have to be modest. Not to talk near their children or in general. The laws of modesty are so strict that even it applies to a man. Not only to a man that is alone in a bathroom. Nobody can see him. He's in a little room. Big deal. How he takes his pants off, how he sits, how he covers himself. For who? There's many reasons for this. This is what Hashem say, I made you my children. I am holy. You have to be holy because you are mine. For that, I'm going to pay you big payment. What do you think? You're doing it for free? Yeah, you're going to get eternity of spiritual pleasure for this. Or chas v'shalom, you lose everything if you're not going to obey the rules. How many of our wives and friends do not want to follow the rules? Some husbands are begging their wife. But some husbands are very foolish. I hear about the many girls that decide to be modest. The husband don't let them. She wants to cover her hair. The husband doesn't let her. Don't embarrass me in front of my friends, he tells her. He's embarrassed from his friends, but not from Hashem. And he's a Shomer Shabbat. If he's not Shomer Shabbat, no, what does he know about life? Shomer Shabbat. I don't want you to cover your hair. What is this? You remind me of my grandmother. The things that they say to them. A person that is proud always thinks that everybody owes him. No matter how much you do for him, he's never going to be satisfied. He's always going to think that you did not do enough for him. Tell me if I'm wrong or not. This is words by words from the Torah and from the Gemara. Not only that, check in a traffic. Two people merge into one lane. Two cars. One has to go first. There's no other way. They fight who's going to be first. They won't even save 2 seconds. In a 5 hours ride, maybe 2 second difference is going to be if this car will be before you. You're going to care that you got there 2 seconds late or 5 seconds late? Nobody really cares about that. It's the ego. Ma, you're going to go before me? You're not going to respect me? But as soon as the guy say, go, right away, you also say, no, you go. Come on, you go. But a minute before, you wanted to kill him. If you had a gun, sometimes they really shoot. They kill one another on the roads. Why? You embarrassed my ego. But now when you surrender, you went like this, I'll give you the world. Because you didn't touch my ego. I don't care, I'll give you money for that. Sometimes people give the article writer money, a lot of money, to write a nice article about them in the newspaper. Yes, you know, in Israel, you have a lot of mafia now, gangsters. So they have a list of the 10 worst criminals in Israel. Each one is the head of a mafia group. And they're all controlling the drugs, the casinos, the prostitutions. And there's a lot of murders going on between one to the other because it's all competition. So, one newspaper reporter wrote the list of the 10 worst criminals in Israel. So one of them wasn't in the list. So guess what? They found out who's the rider. They brought him to the house of this gangster with a gun to his head. You never heard of me? Started to give him a lecture. A week later, there was a private show on television about his mansion, his bodyguards. They interview him. They see how his car coming, bulletproof, coming into the house. Why? I'm not in the top 10 families, 10 criminal families? Oh, what an embarrassment. When it comes to wicked people, even though the Torah says you have to be humbled and surrender, don't fight with people, give up, let them go first, be mochel, don't be stubborn. The Torah gave us advices. But if this person is a wicked guy that hates Hashem and speaks against the Torah, fight with him to the end. Don't surrender to him. Where we learned it from? From Mordechai and Haman. Mordechai in Persia. Haman, everybody bow down to him. Mordechai refused. The whole Jewish nation is in a risk. Mordechai doesn't bow down to him. Baruch Hashem, Hashem helped in the end. It was a big miracle. No, we don't surrender to you. You speak against the Torah, we'll fight with you to the end. Don't surrender to him. But that's why, because when you surrender to him, you humiliate the Torah, the honor of Hashem. What, his honor is more important than Hashem? No. When it comes to the honor of Hashem, even rabbis, if somebody insults them, the halacha said, if Reuven hurt Shimon, Reuven insulted Shimon, how many times Reuven has to ask forgiveness from Shimon? How many times?
Three.
The fourth time, if he doesn't forgive him, it's his problem already. I ask you three times to forgive me, I apologize, I even cried. You don't want to forgive? But if Shimon is a rabbi, even 1,000 times he has to come. Why? It's not the rabbi anymore. It's not an individual. It's Hashem. You insult them, you insult Hashem. That shows you don't respect the Torah. You may not like him personally. You may disagree with his opinions. It's up to you. It's no problem. But you must give him respect, because you're not you and against him. It's you against Hashem. And the Torah says, everything they tell you, you must listen to them. Do not move left or right from what the rabbis tell you. And what's the punishment for that in the Torah? Someone disrespect rabbi, destroy him with no mercy, and clean the dirt out of the Jewish nation, the Torah say. Clean the dirt, Hashem say, clean these people that speak against the rabbi, clean them out of my nation, I'm not interested. Why? The rabbis learned my Torah and gave it to the public. You must give them respect like you give me. Rabbi Akiva in the Gemara says, before Rabbi Akiva, there was Rav Shimon Amsuni, that was his name. He used to teach Torah to his students. And he said, every time the Torah said the word et, it comes to include another law. For instance, kabed et avicha ve et imecha, respect your father and your mother. The Torah could say, respect your parents. Or respect your father, kabed et avicha ve'imecha. Everybody would understand. Why does the Torah have to say ve'et? There's no extra words in the Torah for no reason. If you see an extra word in the Torah, it must teach you something. You have to go to the oral Torah and see what it meant. So the Torah say, lerabot et achicha bechor, to include your oldest brother, that you have to give him also respect. That's what the Torah teach. So, he was teaching that every time the Torah say the word et, every time the Torah say the word et, it comes to teach something else. So one of the students asked him, Rabbi, the Torah say et Hashem Elokecha tira. You have to be fearful from Hashem. But it also say the word et. So who else you have to be afraid of besides Hashem? It's a contradiction. Hashem said, don't be afraid of anyone besides me. Who else you have to respect like you respect Hashem? So the rabbi say, I surrender. I give up. Forget everything I taught you until today. It's all incorrect. Why? You just proved me wrong. Until Rabbi Akiva came and said, no, he was right. What does it mean? Kabed et Hashem Elokecha tira, lerabot talmidei chachamim. That Hashem said, you must fear for me and respect me. And all the Talmidei Chachamim, all the scholars that knows a lot of Torah, the rabbis, you have to respect them like you respect me. And that's why, by the way, some people don't know, if a rabbi comes with his merchandise to the market, let's see, there's a show. Even today, Las Vegas, they sell jewelry. The rabbi comes and open up his booth, all the other booths have to close their merchandise, go away until he finished to sell his merchandise. After it's done, they can come and do business. Rabbis are excluded from taxes. They used to collect taxes for guards, for army, for all kinds of things. The rabbis didn't have to pay. Rabbis don't have to go to the army. They don't have to clean the roads. They used to clean rocks from the roads. The people of the neighborhood, they used to come, they make a day from that time to that time. They want to make a flat road. So people have to pick up rocks or trees, to take trees, to make a beautiful road. The rabbis don't have to come. Rules in the Torah, who has to and who doesn't have to. If somebody insults the rabbi, even if the rabbi says, I forgive you, I'm not insulted, it doesn't bother me what you say about me, It's still not forgiven by Hashem. That's why a person has to be very, very careful, even when he's alone with his wife, not to talk about them. You may not like him, keep it in your heart. Why you have to talk to others? You're only burying yourself, bury yourself, much, much deeper than what you are. So what are you gaining? You can only lose. You cannot change the world. And that's ignorance. When we are not educated, we make a lot of mistakes. Before we finish, there's few other bad traits. Jealousy, anger, being a clown, likes to tell jokes all the time, likes to attract attention in a class, in a family. And when he cannot find somebody to laugh at, he will invent somebody to laugh at. One time I went to a wedding, and my father had a friend that has a son that he's a big clown. He likes to laugh at people. And somebody else in the same table in a wedding also likes to laugh at people. How we say in Hebrew, min matzah et mino. Ba orev etzel hazarzir. That's what the expression that belongs to these people. So they walked around in a wedding to find somebody funny that they could laugh at. So they see somebody, they laugh at him. They see another person, they laugh at him. They all, you know, they drink a little bit, they laugh at people. After an hour, the older person sat down in a chair, and the young guy is still touring around to look for somebody to laugh at. 5 minutes later, he comes to this guy. He says, Danny, you gotta come. What happens? I will show you the funniest face you ever seen in your life. He says, what? He begins to describe him, cross-eyed, this, crooked head, no hair, this, that. Yeah, describe him like a monster. So the guy is so curious to see. He runs with him. He say, here. This guy Danny say, you idiot. He's my father. This is my father. You don't know? He said, I'm so sorry. I didn't know it's your father. Why Hashem did it to him? To feel what the others feel when you laugh at them. There was it was supposed to be enough for him to learn never to laugh at people. You think he stopped? What was the punishment of this young guy? He never got married. Today, 40 years old, never got married. And, interesting, 10 years ago, his heart was hungry for Torah. He wanted to go to yeshiva and make tshuva. So his mother didn't let him. Unfortunately, our parents sometimes destroy us. Instead of helping us, they think they're helping us, they're destroying us. His parents didn't let him, especially his mother. So his mother came to my mother and say, I do not want him to become religious. Who's going to marry him? So my mother told me that. I told my mother, you wait and see. Because she said he will never get married. That was 10 years ago. Every shidduch they offer to him, nobody understands. He gets canceled in the last minute. Why? How is he going to get married if he's going to be a righteous guy that loves Hashem? You heard that nonsense? The master of marriages is Hashem. He's going to give a wife to the wicked people, to the Indians who bow down to Buddha. Even the animals have shidduch. Even Malach HaMavet has a wife. The angel of death has a wife. But the righteous Jews, God forbid, because the righteous, they won't have a wife. You heard this nonsense? That's how foolish people think. Then, proud people also laugh at people who are not successful in business. And if they have also jealousy, when his friend that is very poor finally made a little money, it kills him. He has billions. And his friend that was a big loser for 20 years finally closed the deal and made $50,000. He doesn't sleep at night. Reuven, why are you turning around every 5 minutes? Cigarettes, go to the terrace, come back to bed. What happened? You hear what happened? He finally closed the deal, this guy, made money. It kills him. Why? It's called Tzar Ayin. In Israel, there's a very bad habit. When finally somebody buys a nice car, unfortunately, always, but I mean always, within a week to a month, there will be somebody generous that will come with a nail or something and make such a scratch over the car, thousands of dollars damage. Why? I don't have, you're not gonna have. That's how bad people can be. Why is it? Nobody believes in Hashem. We believe in Hashem, the boss decides to give to everyone what he deserves for his test in life. Your test is to be without a car. Your test is to be poor. Your test is to be single until age 50. Your test is to be sick most of your life. Your test is to be foolish. Your test is to walk like a dog. Your test is got to be very clever and you're going to have a lot of invention and everybody come in the last minute and steal it away from you. Your test is your wife giving you hell in your life. Your test is your kids sucking your blood. You cannot do anything about it. This, everyone has his own test. You think everyone is perfect? So what does he do? He tells Hashem, you don't know what you're doing. I deserve this car, not him. Shh. He ruins. If he can burn it, he burn it. Why? Nobody cares about the pain that the other guy's going to have. A week after he bought this car, he worked 10 years to save the money, you know. Some people, they laugh at other people's defect. For instance, if someone deaf, they come and tell jokes about them next to them. Somebody blind, they make all kinds of things to them because they know they cannot see. Now it's a double sin. First sin is your pride, your arrogant. Second sin is that you laugh at Hashem's creation. Hashem created him. The Gemara say, believe it or not, hard to believe. I couldn't believe this Gemara when I read it, but it's happened. The Gemara says, the son of Rabbi Shimon bar Yochai, Rabbi Elazar, the holy Tana Mechaye HaMetim, reviving the dead. That's how big he was. Buried with his father in Meron, in Israel, Rabbi Shimon bar Yochai and Rabbi Elazar in Meron. Walked on the street with his donkey and he saw a very ugly man. He started to laugh at him. Shh, what? Never saw an ugly person like you in my life, he told him. That's after he learned many years of Torah, he felt so high, like a big shot. That's what the Gemara says. He felt such a big shot. I learned so many years of Torah, I know all the secrets. So he saw this miserable, ugly person in the street, and he said, I never saw an ugly person like you. So the ugly person got very hurt. So he told him, go to the artist who designed my face and complain to him. So Rabbi Elazar was a tzaddik. He realized right away what a mistake he made. He said, please forgive me, I'm sorry. I take it back. In America, it's easy. I take it back. I never say that, but I cannot take it back. Please forgive me, I'm sorry. I don't know what got into my head. But the guy already knows the truth. He's following him all the way to town. The ugly person is first, and he's behind him. Just when they got to town, hundreds of people running, Rabbi! Rabbi! They scream, Rabbi! Psh, Baruch Haba, welcome! The ugly guy turns around. Who are you calling Rabbi? This man behind you. This is a Rabbi! If he's a Rabbi, may the Jewish nation won't have anyone like him. Say, wow, God forbid, how are you talking about him? He's the greatest in the world. The son of Rabbi Shimon bar Yochai. 13 years in a cave with an angel, they wrote the Zohar together. So he told them. So they told him, please forgive him, he's an important person. So he told them, in the end, I forgive you because for them, not for you, for them. How difficult it can be when you laugh at somebody's defect. Someone who is proud, he never gives credit to Hashem. It's always to himself. He tells his wife, what a deal I made in the office today. What a genius I am. Hashem never exists for him. You come and tell him, what are you bragging? Everything you have, Hashem gave you. What? Excuse me? What do you mean, Hashem? You know how hard I worked for it? You know how many colleges I went to? He doesn't know that so many people who went to the same colleges don't have what to eat in the other side of the world. He thinks he brought it. I made all this money. It's all mine. It's thanks to me. I learned, I worked, I did. King Solomon already answered, Lo lachachamim lechem. Wisdom does not bring money. Many wise people don't have anything. Very foolish people are very rich. If Hashem wanted him to be a great leader or an important person, and he started to behave arrogant, proudly, Hashem takes it away and replaces him with somebody else. So if you were supposed to be a prime minister or a chief rabbi of a community and you behave with pride, Hashem one point decides to cancel it from you and give it to somebody else. And you may even not know about it. So, what's the solution? We'll finish with the right advice of the Torah. How do we overcome this sickness? It's like a spiritual cancer among us. First, we have to learn a lot about the supervision of Hashem and this world. Once a person knows that everything that happens in his life, everything is decided by Hashem and he's practically happening only because of the wish of Hashem, then he doesn't have what to take credit for. The only thing that a person is responsible for is if to choose to do good or bad, mitzvot or sins. That's it. Hakol bidei shamayim, chutz miirat shamayim. Everything is in the hand of God, everything, except one thing. What is it? Fear from Hashem, righteousness, or being wicked, it's all in your hand 100%. How healthy you're going to be, how rich you're going to be, how intelligent you're going to be, all these things are basically, even though it can be affected by your choices, basically it's all predetermined. Depend what month you're born, what week, what day, what hour, what second. The second your soul came into the body, has a big effect of your upcoming life. I'll tell you a story for the end. Maybe we'll learn some Musa from this story. Rav Aaron Kotler was the Rosh Yeshiva of Lakewood. In Lakewood you have yeshiva more than 3,000 students. They learn in Lakewood. Lakewood is a big city of Torah. Before Rav Aaron Kotler came from Europe to America, there was here Rav Moshe Feinstein in Lower East Side. Rav Moshe Feinstein was begging him to come to America to help him establish a Jewish world in America. There was nothing here. But Rav Aaron Kotler thought, if I'm going to leave Europe, I might as well go to the Holy Land. Why should I go again to the exile? He wasn't sure where to go. A righteous Jew always asks Hashem, Hashem, I'm begging you, show me the way. Show me what to do. Show me how to do. Where to go. He didn't know what to do, so he did Goral Agra. What is Goral Agra? They have a special way. They open the Torah. On the right side, you get the answer from Hashem. It's after a special blessing, special prayer. Once he did Goral Agra, what came out? What pasuk came out? Lech etzel Moshe. The Torah say, Lech, go to Moshe. The Torah meant Moshe Rabbeinu. What was the name of Rav Moshe Feinstein? Moshe. He got, go to Moshe. That's the answer he got. So he came to America. The rest is history. Everything you see today in America started from that opening the Chumash. He came to Lakewood, started Yeshiva. But not that many people knows the history of Rav Aaron Kotler. So I'll tell you a story. When he was 14 years old, he came to Yeshiva Slovotka. His family, his father passed away already. He didn't have a father. So his family, his uncles, they saw that he's going to yeshiva, but they were worrying about his future. They were not so strictly religious. They were modern. So they came to the Saba Mislobotka, it was the Rosh Yeshiva. They say, hey, Saba, Rebbe, we want to take Aaron to send him to college. to be a dentist. It's a very good job, dentist. It makes good money. They don't tell you you have to smell the garlic of all the people and their breath and, you know, other things. But fine, it's a good job. You make a good living. Okay. So now the rabbi knows that it's going to be a distraction for this boy. If they take him out of yeshiva and send him to university with all the goyim, who knows what's going to come out of him? Chas v'shalom will leave his Judaism. So he said, okay, but give him 3 weeks, three more weeks to learn. 3 weeks. It was new in yeshiva. He just arrived to the yeshiva, so his uncles right away came to take him out. So he said, leave him in yeshiva 3 weeks. Come back in 21 days. What did he do in those 3 weeks? He took the best students in yeshiva and told each one of them, you must be attached to this 14 years old boy. He's a genius. He's very smart. All day you'll be around him. You'll learn with him Torah, one after the other. All the sharp people. Show him the beauty of the Torah for 3 weeks until his family will come again. Well, he knew a genius person, when he sees the brilliance of the Torah, he doesn't want to replace it for diamonds, for anything in the world. Once you taste from it, that's it. Everything else tastes like mud. I'm telling you, 100%. Check today, even in our generation, how many people sit and learn 14, 15 hours a day. They had opportunity, careers, jobs, their parents are rich, whatever you can. They don't want to hear about it. Let me live very simple life in my one-bedroom apartment with my 9 children. I'm very happy. My soul is in the moon, learning around the clock, enjoying every minute. I feel there's no way to describe the feeling of someone who is deeply inside the Torah. It's so great that in my eyes I saw some of these people that have to go one block from the yeshiva to their home, and they found them 2 hours away from their home. Well, Rabbi, what are you doing here? Where am I? 2 hours is walking. It's not in this world, Bechlal. That's how was Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul. Many times, not once. From the yeshiva to his house was one block. 30 seconds to walk. They found him in the other side of Yerushalayim, in the middle of Shabbat. Rabbi, what are you doing here? Cars, he doesn't pay attention. Like he's not in this world. And his students say that his eyes were always moving. Always moving. Not 1 second he's relaxed. He's always inside the Torah, in this Gemara, in this Zohar, in this... Always, not once. Somebody asked him, Rabbi, what mitzvah it's hard to keep? Do you think it's impossible to keep? Everybody thought maybe he's going to say you should love your Jewish fellow like you love yourself. Very hard mitzvah. Guess what the answer is? I don't understand. How is it possible not to learn Torah inside the bathroom? Not allowed to learn Torah in the bathroom, to talk Torah, to talk. Bathroom is a filthy place, impure. So the 10 minutes that he's sitting in a bathroom a day or twice a day, whatever, he was killing himself trying not to think about Torah. He couldn't do it. Maybe he did, I don't know. But he said that this mitzvah is impossible to keep. We don't think Torah 10 minutes a day. He couldn't stop 10 minutes a day not thinking about Hashem and Torah. The soul is attached to Hashem like a magnet. So after 3 weeks, the family of Rav Aaron Kotler came, his uncles. Say, Aaron, pack your stuff, we're taking you to college. He said, excuse me? College? Get out of here, I don't want to hear about you. Goodbye. You're insulting me. How can I leave such a beautiful place? What? You're going to have money. Here you're not going to have anything. What happened in the end? He got saved. Now let's finish with asking you one question. Think for 1 second. What would happen if the uncle of Rav Aaron Kotler would succeed of taking him out of yeshiva and send him to be a dentist? He would come to Hashem after his death. He comes to Hashem to his trial. And Hashem would tell him, Aaron, what did you achieve in your life? He would say, Hashem, I fixed 300 root canals. I did 1,500 cavities. I made some people's teeth wider. some braces to the kids. That's what I achieved in my life. Very nice. I made X amount of money for that. I bought a house. I send my kids to public school, and that's the end of it. And now when he didn't go, what did he achieve? Trillions of mitzvot for learning and teaching Torah. All the Torah we learn in America, it's thanks to him. Everything. Every state in America, you have Torah, it's thanks to him. Everything started from Lakewood. What do you think? 90% of all the rabbis, wherever you go, came from there. How many tragedies to the Jewish world were prevented from him, from his students, from his son, from his grandson that is the Rosh Yeshiva? Ooh, I have hundreds of stories for you, just about him. Who made it? His Rebbe, the Saba Mislovotka, that was clever. Told them, okay, if he would tell them, no, they'll take him, they'll force him to leave. Come back in 3 weeks. After he will taste from the Torah here, he doesn't want to leave the Torah. Bezrat Hashem, remember, we have to remember King Solomon said that in the end the worms will eat us up. Nothing will left from our body. All this beautiful body with the muscles, the beautiful blue eyes and the green eyes and the great hair. Nothing left in the end. It's all temporary. It's 20 years of illusion. Don't use it to make sins. You're not going to get anything from it. You're allowed to be pretty for your husband, no problem. When you're alone with him, be pretty. Be whatever you want. It's legal. Out of your bedroom with your husband, it's illegal to be too attractive for the people on the street. And don't tell me stories that you want to feel good with yourself, because if you'd be on the island with the monkeys, you wouldn't put your makeup on. If you want to feel good with yourself, you would do it over there also. But you won't. Because you want to be pretty for the guys, for Jose, for Vini, for Ahmed on the street. That's the only reason why you get too pretty when you go on the street. The idea is to be pretty for your husband. Nobody else. Kosher woman is pretty for her husband. For nobody else. If you are able to attract attention for other men, that's already show that you fell in your mission. Through the entire Torah, HaKadosh Baruch Hu never praise a woman about anything. Besides one thing, always the same thing, modesty. What about her righteousness? Nobody spoke about it. What about the Shabbat that she keeps? Nobody speaks about it. What about she takes care of the poor, she brings people to the house? The Torah didn't mention all this about Sarah, Rivka, and Rachel, and all the rest. One thing, modesty. That's it. That's all Hashem cares about. You're modest, you have everything. You're not modest, you basically have nothing. Why? Elohim sone zima. Hashem sone. Hashem hate modesty problems between men and women, mingling out of the shul in the lobby. How are you doing today? So where are you going next year? Hashem doesn't love it. Don't be blinded by the Satan, the Yetzer Hara. Follow the Torah. Don't believe me. You don't have to believe a word of what I say. You have the sources. It's going to be on the website if you forget. Go and check. Go and check the laws of modesty. See how strict they are. See how severe it is to attract other men's eyes to your body. If you only knew what a crime it is, you'll never dare to do it. Never dare to do it. If a guy is a guard in a room, and they told him, make sure nobody press this button. Nobody touch this button. That's why we pay you to be here. Nobody press this button. Yes, sir. One time he's drunk, he pressed the button, he doesn't see anything. What happened? Look, they're fooling me, what? It's all a joke. The first time he was very nervous. The next day he drinks again, he pressed the button. Then he go all day like this. You see, nothing happens. After a week, all the generals are coming. Who is the idiots that press the buttons? They look, they have a candy camera, they take the film, they see this fool drinking and pressing the buttons. Every time you press a button, a million people on the other side of the world died. You fool, shooting atomic missiles, chemical weapon is going. What is this? We put you here to guard this button. When you don't see the results of your sin yet, don't assume nothing happened. It's a destruction in the spiritual worlds that one day you're going to have to face. Don't be a fool. Hashem say, you are my daughter, be modest, enough with this fleshy show off in the wedding. How are you? Enough with this. Enough. Hashem love you, his daughter. Hashem is very strict about modesty. Very strict. It's so strict. The Rambam say even a brother should not kiss his sister. Especially if she's married. Even that, how strict it can go. And people, every person from the street kiss her. 5,000 people kiss her a year in front of her husband. He tells his wife, go kiss him. If he only knew what they think about his wife when they kiss her, I would jump from the terrace. The truth is the truth. I know it's not so pleasant to hear. I'm giving you advices to elevate your spiritual level 1,000 times higher. If we're going to illuminate our pride, and we be down to earth like Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul, the greatest Jew in our generation was. Rav Moshe Feinstein, one of the greatest Jews in our generation. His pride was on the floor. Hashem loved Moshe Rabbeinu for one reason. What? Aish Moshe Anav Mikol Adam is the most humbled human being on the world. That's why I love him the most. And he had a lot to brag about, Moshe. God is speaking to him every day. He didn't speak to us yet. But we break non-stop. Moshe, King David. Anochi tolat velo ish. I'm a worm. That's what he said. Avraham Avinu. I'm dust on the floor. Afar v'efer. Moshe and Aaron. Ve'anachnu ma. We are nothing. Why Hashem buried Korach under the ground? He couldn't bring them lightning to kill them, that everybody see their bodies? He couldn't give them heart attacks? He couldn't make a virus that they all die in a day or two? Why he chose to open the ground and swallow them alive? Because Moshe and Aaron were sand on the floor according to their level. They put themselves, they consider themselves as sand on the floor. And Hashem said to Korach, you and your friends want to be above Moshe, you must be below him. Moshe consider himself the ground, you'll be below the ground. That's the only punishment I can give you. Measure for measure. You want to be high, I make sure you're low. The Torah says, everyone who run after honor, the honor will run away from him, guarantee. So one guy came to the rabbi. Rabbi said, 20 years, I'm running away from the honor, and the honor never came to me. The Torah says, if you run after honor, the honor will run away from you. If you leave the honor alone and you run away from the honor will follow you. That's what the Torah says. So one guy came to the rabbi, said, Rabbi, 20 years I'm running away from the honor. He didn't come to me yet. Nobody gives me respect. So the rabbi said, you know how you run from the honor? This is how you run. You run. Where are you? Where are you? You're not coming yet. Of course it's not going to come. The Rambam went to check a goy. They said, this goy is so humble. Rabbi, you never saw such a humble person. The Rambam came to the goy, can I stay in your house for 3 days? I said, sure. Welcome. After 3 days, the Rambam says, you're amazing. I never saw such a humble person like you. But I have a very, very strong question about the Torah. The Torah said that Moshe Rabbeinu is the most humble person ever lived. In my eyes, I saw that you are even more humble than Moshe. How can it be? What is, God forbid, a mistake in the Torah? So the goy told the Rambam, Rabbi, for 30 years I have this question in my mind. It doesn't leave me alone. So the Rambam said, okay, now I got my answer. You are the biggest proud person. 30 years is thinking I'm better than Moshe. How can you be humble like this? Sometimes it's a show. Sometimes it's all a show. How do you know if it's a show? Get the guy a little angry. See how he behaves. He goes to a war. That's it. I had it. Someone who is humble never gets offended. In a wedding, how many families are broken because where they put them to sit in a wedding? What? They put me with the back to the band in this corner? Get up. We're leaving right now. Moshe, relax. Sit down. No. What is this? Give me the check. He erased 2 zeros from the check. He hates his brother for 20 years because he put him in a wedding in not important place, or he didn't let him sit on a stage. Ah, it's a mental disease. Trust me when I tell you, the Torah says it's a complete mental disease. Any questions before we finished?
Rabbi.
Yes.
The idea where you say for the women they have to be modest, modesty is strength, and everything is determined by God. Like, what is the idea of like teshuvah, tefillah? You mean like
teshuvah is a general correction. If a person is not modest, he can correct it. Tshuva and fila, it's a way of making a correction to our sins.
But you make it seem like modesty, or not just modesty, any other law is the only thing. Like, without, isn't it on each person's level? Doesn't it have to be on your level?
I agree with you that Hashem doesn't have the same expectation from every person. For instance, some people, they have a special soul, special brain, and they meant to sit and learn Torah around the clock all their life. Some people are not in this level. If they will learn 4 hours a day, Hashem will be satisfied from them. So obviously, see, not everyone has the same expectation. But when it comes to modesty, there's no exception to the rule. This is a solid rule, solid foundation of Jewish religion. It's so strict that there is no exception to the rule. For instance, the Torah says if a man is a very rich guy and he gives a ketubah to his wife, imagine the amount, 10 million, 100 million, whatever, he writes to her on a ketubah. And one time she came out of the house to the public territory without covering her hair, one time, for 1 second, her son threw a ball from the window and she went to the street, picked it up without covering her hair. And people saw her hair on the street, she lost all her rights from the marriage. If he wants to divorce her because of that, she goes empty to the street. Nothing she takes with her, only one alfet to wear. She lost all her rights in the Jewish court. Why? It's a tragedy to show your hair to other men, but women don't understand this. So they do it for 7 years of their life, even those who keep Shabbat. When a woman is educated and she knows what Hashem is thinking about her walking like this in the street, she's dying from embarrassment. It's like, just imagine if there was a camera that watched you and eliminate your clothes when you walk in the street. You'll be dying to go on the street. You won't go because everybody will see. There's a camera that somebody somewhere sitting and watching. The idea that people do it because they're not aware of their sin. And I want to tell you something you should know. If a Jewish woman keep modesty and Shabbat, she already have 90% of Judaism in her pocket. The rest, everything together, is 10%. Guest, tzedakah, praying, Shabbos candle, you know, making challahs, all these things together, 10%. Modesty, strictly modest, and keeping Shabbat 100%, 90% in her pocket. She's in a very high level in heaven, in paradise. If she doesn't have modesty, she doesn't pass the red line. Doesn't pass. She cannot pass.
What about modesty for girls who aren't married? Or divorced women?
There's no difference. Married or single, they're all subject to the laws of modesty. But a single woman doesn't have to cover her hair. But I have news for you. The Torah really said that every woman that she, at the day that she became not virgin, she must cover her hair. So if she made a sin before her marriage, she must cover her hair. She's already considered eshet ish. Somebody already touched her. But the rabbis, with the authority that Hashem gave them, they made a decree to eliminate the shame from the Jewish ladies that she's 14 or 15 or 16 or 17, she's not married. And she made a sin, and the next day she regretted, she cried, she's dying, Hashem, forgive me, I was a fool, he gave me drink, I don't know what happened. She would have, according to the law, she would have to cover her hair. She walked in the street. Now everybody knows what she did. So to eliminate the shame, which is a very big thing, shame, to embarrass the person, the Chachamim say, we will wait until she gets married. But really, as far as Hashem wanted it, because Hashem didn't expect ladies to make sin before their marriage. There used to be a generation that nobody even dared to think about it, the Goyim. Read Rashi. Rashi lived 900 years ago in France. Rashi writes in a Talmud, all the French Goyot were all virgins. All of them. Rashi writes. And Rashi didn't brag about the Goyim. Didn't give them any compliments unless if they really deserved it. That wasn't his intention in a Talmud. And he gave them the compliment because that was the truth. But he said that they're making a lot of other sins. But for sure, they're going to protect themselves until the day of the marriage. Why? Because if she won't be a virgin, nobody will marry her. Who wants to stay single for the rest of their life to make a sin for 10 minutes? It's destroyed her life. She won't be able to be a mother, nothing. There's a price to pay. Today, nobody cares. Let's get married. But few generations ago, even today by the Arabs, a woman that she's not, nobody wants to marry her. The murderers protect their dignity. And we, the chosen people, don't care. How can we not cry for this? You get it? You get it how low we went? That's the truth. Yes.
Like, I get like a modesty about, you know, this stuff. Is there any like laws against males?
Yes. A boy should never touch a finger of a woman until the day he marries her. Cannot make sins. Not with Jewish ladies, not with non-Jewish ladies. And there are many other laws.
Look-wise,
okay. Now, look-wise, you have to share it to two different departments. We're not allowed to look like the Goyim. So if the Goyim decided that from now on they wear an upside-down or backward baseball hat, we don't have to wear like that. Why? Because this is the way they wear. If the Goyim decided that they want to walk with earrings, that's a new fashion, we're not allowed to look like them. It's a sin from the Torah. If they decide they want to have ponytails, and that's the new style now, we're not allowed to do. If they decide to have short hair here and a lot of hair here, like some of them do, the Torah said not to cut the hair like them. If they decide to do tattoos and stuff like that, we're not allowed to do it. The Torah told us all these things. But this is between not to look like a goy. But besides that, let's say we don't look like goyim. A man has to look modest in his look. For instance, what happens if a man will walk with the underwear in the street? It's called Chilul Hashem. Chilul Hashem. Look at him. He's walking like this in the street. He came from in Israel, you laugh. In Israel, the beach, you go up from the beach, you go right into the street. So people that live two blocks away, they're lazy. They want to start get dressed now. They take their bags and everything. They walk like this in the street. I'm not exaggerating. Without a shirt like this, with underwear. Bathing suit, whatever you want to call it. They walk like this in the street. So that's called Chilul Hashem. It's a very big embarrassment that a Jew that looks like an animal walk like this in the street. So other than the fact that he has to wear tzitzit, he has to wear Jewish clothes. So if the Jews wear special, now today, Jews dress all kinds of jackets and things like this. But in the old days, the Jews have a special clothes, even special shoes. The Gemara described the shoelaces of the Jews compared to the Goyim. The color of the shoes of the Jews, the color of the shoes of the Goyim. So you see from the Gemara, the Jews used to dress in a certain way. Today, the most important thing that the Jew has to look respectable. If he looks respectable, according to the area where he lives, that's called Kiddush Hashem. If he looks disrespectful, you know, with all this weird fashion that they invent.
What does mean dressed?
Respectful, like you dressed. Nice shirt, jacket, very nice. Yeah, serious.
How about
a woman? A woman has to dress modest.
Compared with the same area you're living?
No, I'm saying women has to be modest. But men has to dress respectfully, not short sleeves, cut up everything open, or walk with, you know, short pants in the street, things like this. But let's put it that way. If a man would walk with short sleeves, that's probably the least of his sins compared to all the other sins that we make. Let's put it that way. If you keep all the laws in the Torah, And the only problem you have is that you don't dress 100%, believe me, your situation will be very good. Before we worry about this, we have so many other things to worry about that each one of them is karet for the soul for eternity. Karet, you know, Hashem says, I'm cutting that soul away forever. This first we have to correct. After we correct that, then we're going to correct all the little things. In my lecture, I always focus on the most important things. You hardly ever hear me talking about minor things, even though it's not allowed to call something from the Torah minor, but in relation to Shabbat, it's minor. In relation to Avodah Zarah, it's minor. In relation to sex crimes, it's minor. There's the highlight of the Torah, there's some sins in the Torah that when a person makes it, it's a tragedy for his eternity. There's a very heavy price to pay for not keeping Shabbat, for instance. Sex crimes, not keeping Taharat HaMishpacha with his wife. She doesn't go to the mikveh. Yeah, this is sins that is very difficult to correct. It's destroyed the soul of a person. It's destroyed the children that they're going to have. It's affecting their descendants forever. Everybody's going to suffer from their sins. What do you think? If a woman goes to the mikveh and a woman doesn't go to the mikveh, they don't have the same kids. It's not the same souls. If Hashem sees a woman goes to the mikveh, and she comes to be with her husband that night and Hashem wants to give her a baby, he chooses from all the souls that wait to be reincarnate again in this world, the better ones. And he gives to these parents. So the parents won't suffer so much from these kids. But when the woman is not modest, she doesn't keep the laws of purity and many other sins that she do, and the husband the same, Hashem chooses Hashem Erachem, the filthiest soul, and give it to them. Don't be surprised why it goes together, kids with this kind of parents. Why? Sometimes by looking at the boy, you know who their parents are. A few times I met kids, and I was so impressed from them, and I was sure in my heart that their parents are something special, and later Hashem showed me that I was right. Even though there's always an exception to the rule, because Yitzchak had Esav. Esav didn't become Yitzchak. Yaakov was like Yitzchak, but Esav was a... There's always an exception to the rule. But usually, we are the reason for what we get. Thank you very much. I thank you for inviting me. It was a pleasure being here again. Thank you very much. Please remember, Sunday in Great Neck. I gave the address before. Tell all your friends to come. It's going to be a big event. It's going to be, so expect a lot of people to be there. Bezrat Hashem, thank you very much. Kol tov.